So, welcome. Ethical Matters is our series of Monday evening talks on the things that matter to Conway Hall. Politics, ethics, fairness, and a look at how to live a better life and how to make a better world. And I think completely in keeping with that is Ben Tippet delivering a talk based on his book Split. Ben is a, I'm not reading this from the notes at all. Ben is an educator, activist and writer. He is currently doing a PhD at the University of Greenwich for researching the causes of wealth inequality in the UK. He is a researcher for the Transnational Institute and has written for Novara, Stike and Economy. He has a book out with Pluto Books called Split, looking at the divisions between classes and peoples in the United Kingdom, a subject very close to our hearts. So do please virtually welcome to Conway Hall, Ben Tippet. Thank you, Ben.
Great. Thanks. Thanks for that introduction, Scott. So I think the way this is going to work is I'm going to talk for about 45 minutes on my book, interlaced with some readings from my book. And then I think we're going to open it up to questions and answers. But I guess if you do have questions and answers or clarifications along the way, then type them into the chat box to Scott or to Jeff, and we can try and answer them as well as we go along.
If you can use the questions box, everyone, that's what okay. We're sort of doing the Q&A questions through. And if Ben's happy for us to do that, it's going to be a bit clumsier over the internet, but we'll see what we can do.
Brilliant. Great. Yeah. Thanks, Scott. So maybe I'll just start with, you know, why I wrote the book and, you know, what the book is about. So the book came out of running a series of workshops in secondary schools to kind of look at inequality and class. And I think the thing we found when we were running these workshops was that there were just so many different definitions of class. On the one hand, you know, people thought the class was, you know, just about something like social mobility. You know, it was about your background, and you could, you know, you can really find out about somebody's class position by the accent that they have, or the tastes and preferences that they have for, you know, goods and services. You know, do they like kind of coffee and quinoa, or do they like, you know, kind of like a builder's cup of tea? So there's that kind of theory of class that we found. The other theory of class we kind of, you know, a lot of these school kids were repeating to us was this idea that, you know, the real divide in society is between a liberal metropolitan elite and a kind of old industrial working class. And obviously we've seen that narrative play out in our politics and really define a lot of the kind of political narrative, particularly obviously in the 2019 general election. Another theory of class, and I think the kind of one that maybe sits, you know, the one people come to first when they really think about this issue, is the idea that class is kind of, there's an upper class, a middle class and a lower class, you know, and class is this social hierarchy that kind of determines status, esteem and respect. But actually, you know, and because of that, a lot of people who maybe see themselves as like lower class or working class don't really want to associate with that. We found that as well because of the fact that they didn't want to put themselves at the bottom of a hierarchy. The thing that was kind of really interesting though, and the reason why I wanted to write the book was because one of the kind of main theories of class wasn't really being discussed in these workshops. And that was the kind of Marxist theory of class as the idea of capital versus labor, or the idea that class is kind of connected to your ownership over the kind of assets in the economy. And I'm going to come on a little bit to talk about this definition, but I, you know, in a way this is interesting because I kind of think this definition of class is incredibly important to understand how the modern economy functions. And yet when you try and talk to people about capital and labor, a lot of the time people kind of don't really want to hear about it. Maybe they think that it's, you know, overly academic and inaccessible language, or it's, you know, it's ideological and it's something that doesn't really relate to the modern day, you know, it's an outdated thing. So really with the book, what I wanted to do is to try and tell a story of why capital and labor is I think one of the key forces that shapes inequalities in the global economy today, and try and tell the story in a way that is, you know, hopefully like engaging and entertaining and doesn't just repeat kind of slogans that we've heard on the left, I guess, for the last 100 years. So that's kind of what I wanted to do with writing the book. And I'm going to just start with a reading from the first chapter of the book, from the first page of the book, which I think kind of sets the ground for maybe why there is this confusion about class, you know, why we don't have a clear definition of class, and why there's so many competing ideas around this concept that is still, we all think that it's important, but we can't kind of come up with an idea of, you know, exactly how to use it. So this is from the introduction. Britain is famed for its rigid class hierarchies. From mustachioed gentlemen with stiff upper lips to industrial workers with dirty overalls and parochial accents, the British class system has been neatly stereotyped and typecast into the national story. This rosy and nostalgic picture of class relations has been retold to the world for over 100 years. At the time of writing, the most expensive TV show ever made is The Crown, a 10-part Netflix drama detailing the customs, relationships, and power battles in the highest echelons of Britain's class system. The series focuses almost exclusively on the lives of the royal family and elite politicians, who exist in a separate world to the rest of society. In the words of the late Harry Leslie Smith, a Second World War veteran and international Twitter star, The Crown is like an expensive painting in which the only subjects in focus are the rich and the privileged. Now, the director of The Crown, Stephen Daldry, seems less captivated with the glittering allure of royalty and more with a romantic representation of the British class system, having directed another famous drama at the other end of the class ladder, Billy Elliot. Billy Elliot recounts the story of a young working class boy who aspires to be a ballet dancer, set in the northeast of England against the backdrop of the 1984 to 85 miners' strike. It dramatizes the hardship faced by coal miners in their struggle to defend their livelihoods. The strike was a watershed moment in British class history. Due to both its size, it was the country's largest strike since 1926, involving over 142,000 mine workers, and because of the long-lasting impact it has had on British working class political power. Now, the historic importance of the disputes is captured in a poignant scene towards the end of the film. Billy Elliot's father, Jackie, is a single parent and a coal miner out on strike. Having not earned an income for months, he is struggling to put food on the table, let alone pay for each of Billy's 50p ballet lessons. But when Billy is accepted for an audition at the Royal Ballet School in London, but cannot afford the bus fare down, his father is forced to make a choice between his child's future and the struggle of his community. In the end, Jackie breaks the strike. Returning to work, he is met by a crowd of strikers who formed a picket line to keep the mine closed. In the crowd is Billy's older brother, Tony, who among shouting and heckling of the crowd, spots his father trying to break the strike. Stunned and furious, he pushes over a police officer and chases after his dad before shouting in desperation, "You can't do this. Not this time. Not now." Jackie responds by falling to the floor, sobbing, "We're finished, son." Audiences from around the world have an insatiable appetite for these romantic displays of Britain's class hierarchy. The Crown will be released on Netflix over the next decade, while Billy Elliot is now an onstage musical touring the world from Korea to the US, with Downton Abbey, Victoria, and Call the Midwife as popular additions. Class is a lucrative British export. Now, these programs have one thing in common. They represent a nostalgic vision of class from a bygone and simpler times. Now, this reflects the widespread belief that class is something of the past, that it doesn't neatly apply to the present or hold as an appropriate vision of the future. And even in those rare cases where class is used to explain some major political event, think Brexit or Trump, it is always based around the old stereotype of the working class as a white male industrial worker. So to think seriously about class, we need to shake off this nostalgia. And the best way to do this is to go back over recent history and ask why our understanding of class has not kept up with the times. So in terms of answering that question, which is really what I try and do in the introduction of the book, you know, why hasn't our understanding of class kept up with the times? Why is there this confusion about class? And I think part of the answer is to do a little bit to do with that phrase that you hear about, you know, that kind of your grandmother or your mother might tell you, which is when you're pulling a funny face and the wind changes, you know, if you're pulling a funny face, they say, like, don't pull a funny face. If the wind changes, it's going to be stuck like that. And I think what's happened with our class relations is that our kind of analysis of class has kind of been stuck in the 1980s, because this was the last time that actually we had a real kind of class battle, I guess, like a class narrative that was dominant and really dominant in British politics. Because what happened in the 1980s, and that is well documented in the film Billy Elliot, is that this was the kind of, you know, what happens really in terms of the miners' strike, obviously, is that they lose the strike to that Margaret Thatcher's government. The pits are closed down. This huge unemployment in these old powers of organized labor in the UK, and you know, then we had decades of basically neglect, social decay in these areas, and deindustrialization. And this kind of wasn't obviously something that just happened in Britain. This kind of happened across countries in the global north, as jobs were either kind of destroyed by automation or they were relocated to areas in the global south. And I think this kind of, the fact that, you know, in a way we need to think about that when we live through kind of epochal moments, and I guess right now we are living through an epochal moment, you know, a period where history changes so much, it can kind of be hard to understand where our own individual lives fit into that narrative. But we kind of want to think about these things as kind of periods of social change. And kind of what happened in the 1980s was kind of a widespread thing of social change that we kind of now term as this kind of, this term that we call neoliberalism. And, you know, the term's like thrown around a lot now. And so I just kind of want to maybe draw out a little bit about why it's important. And I think one of the central premises of neoliberalism is this idea that we live in an economy in which to be successful, you have to be a kind of competitive individual. You know, individual competition is really the driving force of neoliberalism. And to kind of see why, and I think in a way, Billy Elliot is at his heart a moral parable about this. So at the end of the film, I hope this isn't too much of a spoiler alert, I guess, for people that might want to watch the film. Billy actually, what he does is he goes, so he does actually take ballet lessons. He goes to his audition, which is at the Royal Ballet School in London. You know, he leaves the kind of poverty and the bitter industrial disputes of his working class community behind him, and actually manages to win a place at this school, and kind of, you know, leaves his community and goes down to London. And I think the kind of message is clear really from the film. It's that to be a competitive individual, you kind of succeed. You know, Billy's this very talented individual ballet dancer, and he succeeds by leaving behind his community. While his community, on the other hand, when they fight along class lines, they fail. And so there's this kind of narrative that says collective struggle won't really get you anywhere in life, and actually kind of organizing around your class will lead you to failure. And so that idea really that class doesn't matter anymore, you know, or in a way, if you do it, then you're going to be a bit of a loser. That I think that's just been such a dominant narrative under this idea that we're kind of living in an economy of individual competition. So why does this matter? I mean, I guess on the one hand, you know, class is just, you know, just because we haven't necessarily been talking about class over the last 80 years or necessarily been really been thinking about it, doesn't mean it's gone away. And this is why I think we need to have an analysis of capital and labor to really understand why class hasn't gone away. And so to kind of move on, I guess, to the next part of this talk, I'm going to do another reading from another section of the book. So this is from chapter 4. It's called Money, Who Wants to Be a Billionaire? And I'm going to use it as a way to try and explain what I mean by capital and labor and why I think this is an important way to see the economy today. Let me just take a little drink.
Ben, we do have a question if you care to.
That would be good, actually. Yeah.
Brilliant. Okay, bear with me. Sorry, then you can do your reading. Tejas, we've opened your microphone if you want to ask Ben a question. Hello.
Hello.
Hello there.
Hey, Ben.
Hello, how's it going?
Great, yeah. So I read the ebook version of your book. So it was a great read.
Amazing.
So I guess my question is linked to what you're going to read next, but maybe that will help you set it up. So in the book, you mentioned that there's one of the problems with the capital labor setup is that there's no real upward mobility in society. So I guess my question is, how do you see us removing capital from the equation so that you can establishing some sort of a true meritocracy or true, like, how do you think that money can be actually removed from this equation or removed as the basis of class divide? Because if the problem is that we don't have a true meritocracy, how can we ever have that if money remains the basic driver of class divide?
Really, really good question. You know, and I think this is one of the hard things really about discussing class is that on the one hand, you know, you don't want to just constantly talk about all of the class inequalities that exist in society without actually ever trying to think about how you can challenge them, because you end up just like reinforcing them and making it feel like, you know, it's inevitable that we're just going to live in an incredibly unequal world and there's nothing we can really do about it. What I might try and do is just park your question for a second, because I want to come to that really in the last part of my talk, which is, yeah, how do we organize to overcome the kind of vicious class relations and the inequalities that really shape the world? So if I think before we get to that, maybe what we need to do is we need to think a little bit about this capital labor relationship. You know, what is it? Why does it matter? Because I think maybe for some people, it may be something that people have heard about, but I think it's really important to draw out exactly what we mean by it, which is what I'm going to move on to now in this section on billionaires. So Mark Zuckerberg, Bill Gates, Jeff Bezos, Kylie Jenner, Elon Musk, Trump. These billionaire celebrities are some of the most recognizable names in the world. Their wealth brings them fame, and their fame brings them wealth, vindicating what the economist Adam Smith could see as far back as 1759. The rich man glories in his riches because he feels they naturally draw upon him the attention of the world. Today, the wealthy don't just catch our attention, they draw our admiration. From mainstream economists to politicians, we've been told that the wealthiest in society are at the top because they deserve to be there. Through hard work, intelligence, and creative thinking, they have built companies and innovative products that billions throughout the world need, want, and desire. whether it's keeping up with friends thanks to Zuckerberg's Facebook or using Bezos's Amazon to shop without getting out of bed, we're told that the richer they get, the wealthier we become. Or as the phrase goes, a rising tide lifts all boats. There are 2,153 billionaires in the world. Their combined wealth is 8.6 trillion. Now, the above argument might suggest that they deserve their wealth, that more money at the top means more money for the rest of us. But is this true? I'm now going to move, I think, from the book to actually some stuff that's happening a little bit more in the economy today with the COVID crisis. Because obviously this has just been one of the most unprecedented periods of economic change that we've ever, you know, that's happened over the last 100 years. In fact, it feels like what's happening now with the COVID crisis will dwarf even the economic impacts of the 2008 financial crisis. And there's so many issues connected to class and to capital and labor that relate to the current crisis. I'm just going to think, this question of, you know, why are some people rich and other people poor? You know, why are some people paid more than others? Why do some people own more in the economy than others? This is one of the most fundamental questions, I think, about class. And as we heard, you know, according to the theories in mainstream economics, really how much you're paid reflects like how productive you are as a person. You know, the more skilled, educated, experienced and profitable you are, the more you're going to be rewarded. But actually what this really kind of ignores is the fact that wealth and pay and income is actually a reflection as much about social and political power as it is about, you know, how skilled or educated you are. And there's always been this kind of thought experiment, I guess, that people on the left have tried to kind of, you know, a hypothetical thought experiment that they've put out that they've done to try and kind of expose this point that pay and wealth is a reflection of social and political power rather than kind of like how productive you are. And it goes something like this. You know, imagine for a moment if all of the like private equity managers in the city of London just couldn't turn up to work. You know, and the question is like, how much of an impact would this make on our lives? Now, I think there probably is maybe a case to be said that, you know, people not being able to do these jobs could significantly damage the economy. But then there's also maybe an argument to say that actually, you know, it's not unreasonable to ask whether the world might actually be a better place. But compare this to an alternative, which is where all the paid carers, you know, the workers that look after our children, our elderly and our sick, whether these people stop turning up to work. Now, the negative human impact then would be undeniably immediate and devastating. Now, that's the kind of thought experiment that, you, in fact, like I write about it in this book. If you pick up, I think, Bullshit Jobs by David Graeber, he basically makes a very similar thing. I actually saw that Owen Jones tweeted on Twitter the other day, basically something from his book that says almost something identical. So this has kind of been a very common refrain, like this thought experiment on the left. But what's interesting about the COVID crisis is that this thought experiment has literally become a reality. You know, across the world, care workers have made it onto every government's list of essential workers, while private equity managers obviously haven't. In fact, I don't think any private equity hasn't appeared on any of those lists. And I think in the UK today, we can understand a lot about class dynamics by looking at the relationship between care workers and private equity managers. So actually before the crisis struck, so before this COVID crisis struck, many of Britain's care homes, I think there's like 12,000 care homes in Britain today, have been bought out by asset management firms, by private equity firms. And I think something like 95% of the sector now is run by a private organization. But that's both for-profit and charities, but a huge proportion of them are run by for-profit organizations. And so you know, and the reason why is because these private equity firms have been lured in by the sense by things like demographic change. You know, we're going to have a huge aging population over the next 15 years. We're going to see, I think, like huge numbers of people entering the care homes. And basically private equity firms, you know, they see this as a kind of smart bet, or in their terms, they call this kind of quote, unlocking value. And the kind of the question, so there's a question here basically. So you have within something like a care home, this like very clear relationship of power, this very kind of hierarchical relationship of power, where those that own the care home through the private equity firm are reaping millions and millions of pounds in profits, while those who actually have to go and do the work are some of the most exploited and underappreciated and low-paid people in the British economy. So, in fact, actually, today a report, or yesterday a report came out from the Resolution Foundation that said over half of the frontline care workers in our care homes are actually being paid less than the real living wage. So they're getting paid poverty, they're getting paid poverty wages. That's over half of the frontline care workers are being paid poverty wages. And I think if you're working in a care home, you're more than five times more likely to be on a 0 hours contract than compared to other workers in the economy. And what I'm going to talk about next, I guess, is the way in which class, gender and race are compounded. But you can really see this in the care industry. 83% of frontline carers are women, and they're much more disproportionately likely to be Black, Asian or minority ethnic, or migrant workers from Eastern Europe. Now, there's a really important point at the center of all this, which is what I call the kind of capital labor relationship. Okay, well, I don't call it, this is theory taken from Karl Marx. I mean, I'm just repeating it and applying it to this case. And really at the center of the relationship is this concept or this term called exploitation. Now, I find, you know, even bringing up the concept of exploitation, again, it's one of these concepts that maybe people think is like ideological or doesn't, you know, neatly describe kind of how the economy works today. But let's like really clearly define it. You know, exploitation is when one group of people controls and appropriates the labor of another group of people through their ownership of the workplace. And there's, you know, as I said, there's this clear hierarchy. The owners get rich by controlling the actions of the people that work. Okay, so, and this is, I guess, one of the crucial things we can take away about class within Marx, which is that the workers are they're not passive in their own exploitation. They're active in it. You know, these private equity firms making millions and millions of pounds off our care homes can only make millions of pounds if people get up each day and go to work. You know, without that, there wouldn't be exploitation, there wouldn't be money, there wouldn't be profits, and there wouldn't be wealth. Now, when we kind of try and describe that, I guess, in the normal functioning of the economy, it becomes a bit harder. But I think now, in the COVID-19 crisis, we can see this fact that the importance of the work comes from the workers rather than the people that own the care work. You know, we see this more than ever because of the fact that literally the people who have to go to work are these workers, while private equity managers really, I mean, I guess they do stuff from home, but really at the end of the day, it's hard to, you know, their work isn't in any way near deemed as important. And so like the power really is in the hand of care workers in this case. Now, I think, you know, why are we talking about care work in this current crisis? I mean, I don't know how many, like, I don't know how many people are kind of tuning in from outside of the UK or not, but the real big scandal of the crisis at the moment in the UK is the just the absolute shocking undervaluing and underreporting of what's been happening in British care homes. There's been a huge official underreporting of the number of deaths of elderly people in UK care homes. What, you know, what we're seeing in Ireland, Belgium and Spain is apparently that half the number of people who have died from COVID-19 have actually died in residential care. In the UK, we just haven't really been measuring these deaths. And it's only now that we're starting to actually measure them. And I think in an estimate that came out today said the figure could be, you know, already above 7,000 people who have died in care homes. And then let's go to another issue of the way in which the class and the COVID crisis really relate to each other, which is this idea of testing. Lots of access to tests has been like another huge controversy in the UK. And I think one of the big controversies has been the fact that if you're a celebrity and you're rich and powerful, then you can get access to a test. When if you're a frontline NHS worker, it's been incredibly hard. Even within the healthcare workers there, what we see is a kind of a class inequality there, because NHS workers, I think, have had something like 50,000 tests so far. Oh, they probably had more now, but I think these stats were from last week. When, 50,000 tests for NHS workers, social care workers have only had 505 tests, despite the fact that we're potentially looking at half the number of deaths happening in social care. So this has been by far one of the hardest hit sectors that has been so undervalued and exploited. And I guess I want to make the argument that in a way, the fact that the sector has for so long been kind of undervalued and exploited is part of the reason why we haven't really been paying attention to it now. And I'm going to come on a little bit, I guess, to kind of maybe how these kind of things might be able to be overcome. But this kind of leads me, I guess, to my next point, which is how class relates to the issue of gender. Because as I said, 83% of people in these care homes are women. And that there's this kind of, as I kind of started with, we have these like old conceptions that really class is seen in quite masculine terms. There's the idea that like the working classes are these like industrial workers with their kind of overalls, or the coal miners. And these are like very masculine tropes of class. When in the British economy today, throughout all of time, but really today, what we can really see is the fact that this is an incredibly outdated and gendered conception of class. Actually, those who do work, those who kind of participate in labor, and as we can see from the care home example, those who are exploited by it, tend to be, a disproportionately are women. And maybe there's one kind of way in which we can draw out a couple of, how this works. And it's through one of the kind of big things whenever you discuss gender and class is this idea of the gender pay gap. Let me just have a quick set. So the gender pay gap, there's lots of different ways to measure it. Basically, there's actually a little bit of confusion about what the gender pay gap is. So what it actually technically is if you lined up everyone in the British economy, you lined up all the women on one side, you lined up all the men on the other side, and what you would compare is the two people in the middle. You would look at how much more the middle male person was being paid compared to the middle female person. And what we tend to see when we do that is that men are on average paid, or the middle man is effectively paid the woman is effectively paid like 80% less than the man. And there's loads of different reasons why this is the case. One of the problems with the gender pay gap is we tend to see it just as something that relates to the very richest in society. So there's been these kind of debates, been a very kind of public debate in the BBC about the top kind of celebrities and stars in the BBC being paid different amounts. People like Gary Lineker or Chris Evans being paid much more than the top female stars like Claudia Winkleman, like four times as much. But the problem with really thinking about the gender pay gap in that sense, just looking at the top, is that really it ignores what's happening at the bottom of the economy. It ignores the experience of most people's lives and most women's lives. Or, you know, there's no analysis in that in what is happening to the conditions in care homes, let's say, which is actually where most people, you know, not in care homes, but most people aren't going to become millionaires and billionaires or BBC celebrities. So we really need an analysis of the gender pay gap that looks at what's happening across most of the economy rather than just at the top. And I kind of think there's three different things that are kind of causing the gender pay gap. On the one hand, it's just this kind of idea of direct discrimination. You know, the idea that you might have two people who are equally qualified going for the same job, a man and a woman, and the employer just discriminating against the woman. And that's kind of what the BBC case is, yeah? It's like two people doing exactly the same job, Claudia Winkleman and Chris Evans, both kind of like running high profile programs at the BBC, but Claudia Winkleman effectively being paid much less. And this kind of unequal pay for the same work, there is this that goes on in the economy, and it explains a little bit of the gender pay gap, but it's by no means the defining factor for why we have a gender pay gap. In fact, the defining factor, there's two other reasons. The second reason is the idea of occupational segregation. So this is the idea that in our economy, we have professions that are kind of traditionally stereotyped as being male professions and female professions. So for, you know, it might be lawyers versus secretaries, or I don't know, carers versus doctors, or yeah, nurses versus doctors, or this kind of thing. And so like there is this occupational segregation. Now that wouldn't necessarily have to lead to a gender pay gap, but it does because of the fact that, surprise, surprise, the jobs in which women are segregated into are the least well-paid and the least valued jobs, such as, for example, care work. So that's kind of a huge cause of the gender pay gap as well. And the last point is the fact that it's also about the unequal distribution of unpaid labor within the home. So we know that obviously we live in a society in which for each of us to be sitting where we are now on this Zoom call, listening to me talk about the gender pay gap, if you think back to your life, there's probably thousands of meals that have had to be cooked for you, clothes that have had to be washed for you, people that, Natalie is laughing in the corner, my girlfriend, so I'm good. all of these, you know, like loads of different things have had to be done for you for free. And it's just a fact about the world that this will most likely have been done for free by a woman. We live in an economy in which, in the UK today, in which I think women still do over double the amount of domestic free labor within the home. And basically this is one of the really key factors about why within the paid workplace women are paid less, because of the fact that when, you know, if they have children or even just having to take on caring responsibilities, they have to they effectively have to take a pay cut in the formal economy to enable to do these things. So it's kind of the idea of the double burden. Okay, I think that's probably a good place to end in terms of the gender stuff. Maybe this is a nice point to move on to the other, identity, I guess, that relates to class, which is race. Okay, so, you know, we often hear this kind of thing that's like, either you're just about class, you're just about race. And move on to my chapter 9, which is the chapter in which I discuss this. And I'm just going to start again with another short reading, and then we can have a little discussion about that. So this is chapter 9, Race. The common man has been abandoned, left behind and betrayed by the liberal metropolitan elite that care more about political correctness and foreigners than they do about dealing with the real problems of ordinary people. From Trump to Brexit, this political argument has become a defining feature of mainstream politics. The right-wing movements across Europe and the US have wielded it, claiming to represent the voice of the real and authentic working class. Yet scratch the surface of what authentic really means, and the argument quickly slides into a narrative about race. Take, for example, Brexiteer Nigel Farage, who has gone from the trading floors of the City of London to anti-establishment man of the people. In the lead up to the Brexit referendum in 2016, Farage rephrased the narrative above in blunter terms. Quote, immigration has left our white working class as an underclass. To understand the power of this narrative, we must remember that the far right are not the only group in society that see the working class as white. In a 2019 research project, young people from across the capital were interviewed about their views on race and class. Many of those interviewed were young black women, not what you might call Nigel Farage's key demographic support base, yet they too shared the idea that the working class was for white people. Joy, who was in her 20s, said, quote, I never thought of class applying to black people. I feel like that word white has been attached to working class for so much that nah, I can't identify with it. Similarly, 19-year-old Grace said, when I was young, I didn't think class was a real thing. I thought it was on TV in the Victorian times. And then in sociology, we were talking about class and working class people. You think a coal miner, white people. So to understand why the language of class has become racialized, we need to delve into our history, looking at four key historical moments in our past that can help us untangle the complicated relationship between race and class. So I won't go through four examples now, but I mean, there's different complicated arguments. Oh, somebody's raised their hand. Should we leave them? So it is a complicated history, the history between race and class. I want to just talk. So the question is really, why, you know, where does the power of this narrative that we've seen in Trump and we've seen in Brexit and we're seeing in right-wing movements across the world actually come from? I think part of the power of the narrative comes from the fact that it is such an old and established narrative within our society and within our institutions. You know, this isn't something that just appeared miraculously in 2016. This is something that's really been built into the British economy and into the global economy over the last 300 or 400 years. And we can really see this if we go all the way back to the founding of Britain's first colony in the US. So the first colony in the US, which was Virginia, was established in 1607. Now Virginia is obviously famous for tobacco, and in the tobacco fields it's obviously very famous for slavery. What's interesting is that when the first African people were enslaved and brought over to Virginia, when they actually arrived in Virginia, which was in 1619, so a few years later after the colony was established, they didn't actually arrive as slaves. They came as indentured servants, which was the same way that actually a lot of Europeans came at the same time. And so in this early days, you know, it wasn't by any means a kind of equal, like, you know, multicultural paradise by any means. You know, people were, there was tensions for sure, but people weren't kind of explicitly segregated along racial lines. You know, there were interracial marriages between people. Now, for the kind of British colonial elite in Virginia, they really saw this as a fundamental problem. You know, they wanted their servants, their indentured servants, to be working in the tobacco fields. They didn't want them to, and they're using a quote, flee or fornicate. And really, this kind of crisis of governance hit the British colonial elite in 1676, which is when a kind of multiracial mix of these indentured servants rose up and overthrew the town of Jamestown, which was the capital of the colony. And they actually made the governors and the colonial elite have to flee back to England. So when these kind of groups were back in England, they returned back to Virginia with an army. They put down the rebellion. And then over the next few years, they developed a system of racial laws to really segregate people along racial lines. And it was actually only in 1682, so this is a good like 70, 80 years after the colony was established, that they first created the institution of slavery. And the institution of slavery was created at the same time that this idea of whiteness was created. So in the law, the first time that whiteness was actually ever, you know, the term white was actually ever used was in 1691. And to be white meant basically to have the right to own land. You know, it was really tied to this idea of ownership. So to be white meant that even if you were poor today, you could, you know, you could work hard, you could get some land, and you could in the future potentially make some wealth. Well, obviously to be black was to be denigrated as a form of property. It was to be considered a slave. And what the colonial elites found that this was an incredibly effective way to kind of divide and rule. And so because of that, it was kind of reproduced across the growing kind of British Empire. And it came with its own ideology of like racial science, which we're not really going to have time to go into today. Now, I think a lot of this narrative kind of has, we still saw it even back into the kind of the 1950s and the 1960s, when we're looking at the other side of Britain's empire and the demise of Britain's empire. And, you know, let's think about something like the Windrush, the HMT Windrush, which kind of came in 1948. And the people, you know, we have these kind of, so you have the Windrush coming, and then in the late 60s, you have a kind of another kind of crisis in the British state of immigrants coming, kind of non-white immigrants coming to the UK, and is kind of considered to be a bit of a national crisis. And this was in 1968 in the whole Enoch Powell Rivers of Blood speech. Now, Enoch Powell, he was a conservative politician. He gave this famous speech basically saying something very similar to what we kind of saw in some of the kind of debates around Brexit. This idea that like there were kind of too many immigrants, they're a drain on public services, there's a liberal elite conspiring to kind of hide this from the kind of ordinary working class. And this was in 1968. And in response to that, the Labour government at the time implemented one of the kind of most racist pieces of legislation, which was the Commonwealth Immigration Act. And basically it stopped people from emigrating at the time, based on the fact that you were only allowed to come to the UK if your grandfather effectively came from one of the white colonies, but not from one of the black colonies. So basically, like, you could come if you were from Australia or if you were from Canada, but you couldn't come if you were a British citizen coming from, in this case, a lot of the people coming from East Africa, fleeing changes that were happening in Kenya. So we really saw that narrative in the 1960s. And then when the 1970s came along, what you see is a real rise in kind of the far right racist street movements. Like the National Front was kind of really established at this time and became a leading became like a quite a dominant street movement in certain parts of the UK, like East London. But obviously this was matched by a kind of resistant anti-racist movement as well. You know, people didn't just take this lying down. And I think one of the most interesting things for our class analysis is something that happened in 1976, which is something called the Grumwick strike. I don't know if any of you guys, I'm sure probably people have heard about the Grumwick strike, but for those of you who haven't, the Grumwick strike was, it was dubbed the strikers in saris. These were predominantly women. They were predominantly migrants. And they were working in a kind of photo processing plant in North London. And they were effectively being treated badly by their management. Their wages were being undermined. They were called things like chattering monkeys and stuff. And so they decided to go on strike. And this strike was a real pivotal moment in British working class history. In 1976, in the summer, it was kind of a really hot summer, 20,000 protesters came to join the strike. And what was really interesting is that much of the British trade union working class movement came out to support the strike that day, including people who the year before, like the London Dockers, for example, who 10 years before, sorry, were supporting Enoch Powell in his kind of racist speech. These dockers actually came out in solidarity with these striking women in saris, these migrant workers who were taking action to really take control of their workplaces. And, you know, this was a really powerful moment of multi-ethnic solidarity. But what happened is that, unfortunately, you know, from a historical perspective and also just from a personal perspective, the people involved is that the trade union movement, the British, like, trade union movement effectively withdrew their support after kind of following a very heavy police crackdown and pressure from kind of more racist parts of the movement. And this defeat really cast like a very long shadow over organized labor movements in the UK. One guy at the time said, you know, the dispute was winnable, but defeat was snatched from the jaws of victory. And the important thing is that this was really one of the first moments in which like organized working class power towards the end of the 1970s was defeated. The ex-Labour MP now, Dennis Skinner, said that what happened at Grumwick was a testing ground for the class battles of the 1980s and the subsequent decline of the trade union movement. You know, the Grumwick was one of the first dominoes to fall, really. And so that really takes us back to the kind of Billy Elliot story. You know, the trade union movement lost in Grumwick partly because of the fact that they didn't organise along class lines. They then lost again in the 1980s. And really that's seen the decline of the organized British trade union movement in lots of ways. You know, we've gone from having membership, trade union density and membership levels of something like 40, 50% of the workforce to now something like 25% of the workforce. We've seen nearly like a halving of trade union density. So I think that's an important thing to remember when we come to race and class. I guess that was a very long-winded way, or a very like kind of historical long-winded way of really saying that, you know, obviously race compounds with class to kind of entrench inequalities. But at the same time, you know, like the only way to really truly overcome a lot of the class divisions in our society is to make sure that we don't let racial hatred kind of divide the working class. And, you know, we desperately need like a united anti-racist working class movement to fight back against that. And I think that's really the historical story of Grumwick and why I've kind of spent some time, I guess, trying to expose that. How long have I been going for? I think, do I have, I probably want,
about how 50 much? Minutes. About 50 about minutes.
50 minutes, okay, cool. That's good. So what I'll move on to now is, what should I move on to now? I'll move on to, well, what, as we're talking, I guess, maybe this is a good time to go to Tejas's question, you know, so why, yes. Yep.
Oh, yep. Tejas's question. Sorry.
As in the one, do we have any other questions?
We've got 7 so far, and I'm sure that will multiply very soon.
Why don't we take a question? Yeah, maybe let's take another question. Then, yeah.
Let's do it. So we've got a number here. So we're going to go to Graham Taylor first.
Yeah.
Graham, I'm about to open your microphone. Hi, Graham.
Can you hear me?
We can, Graham.
Yeah, thank you. During the inequality session, during the neoliberalism period in the 80s, we saw facts right years need to be down the NHS. You've been all down. It was a terrible facetious act on the right wing side of things. Do you think the inequalities are now beginning to decrease in this country? And do you think that the poor are now making a comeback in wealthy situations in capitalism standards?
Yeah, that's a brilliant question. So, I mean, firstly, there's different ways of measuring inequality. Yeah. I look a lot of wealth inequality. Okay, so this is, and particularly the measure I look at is how much wealth is how much wealth is owned by the top 1% relative to the rest of society. If we look at that measure, then the last 15 years, more so than actually the last 40 years, has seen a tremendous increase in wealth inequality. Let me give you a statistic. So from 2009 to 2015, so this period where the economy was kind of collapsing, we had extreme austerity, there was considered to be no more money in the economy. The richest 1,000 families in the UK doubled their wealth. Okay. And this was at a period in which wages, average wages, completely stagnated and declined. In fact, does anyone know, I mean, ask it as a rhetorical question because we're not kind of in a group, but, you know, does anyone know when wages, average wages, only returned to their pre-2008 levels? It was actually only in February this year. So it was only like 2 months ago that wages only like came back to what they were in 2008. So that's 12 years of wage decline. And now we have the COVID crisis, wages are going to go down again. So we're looking at basically potentially 20 years, unless something drastically changes, 20 years of no wage growth in the UK. While obviously other prices in the economy are massively increasing. House prices, for example, have increased something like by 200% between the 1990s and the 2008 and have increased further since. So along these levels, inequality has increased a lot. If you're looking at the incomes of the very poorest people in society, there has been a collapse over the last few years of, I think, the incomes of the bottom 20%. There was a paper that was released, I think, by the IFS or the Resolution Foundation a few months ago, that really looked at how, I think the bottom fifth, actually, it was in the bottom 20%, the bottom fifth of incomes in the UK, wages in the UK, have declined quite dramatically over the last few years. So I think along this sense, under neoliberalism, yeah, we've seen a huge explosion in inequalities around incomes and wealths, around income and wealth. Yeah, I think this is kind of very well documented now as a global phenomenon as well, with people like Thomas Piketty, who really kind of put a lot of the statistics of some of this stuff together. Cool. Okay. I mean, that's maybe a good point actually to move on to my last point, because, you know, one of the problems I think we're talking about class and inequality is that you become a little bit like the war photographer in a way. Like, you just document all these kind of horrible things that are happening, rather than like actually kind of thinking or kind of even intervening to overcome them. And, you know, like, war photographers are often criticized for, like, people say, how can you put a camera up in the face of a dying child rather than like intervening to like save it, kind of thing. And I feel like there is a slight worry sometimes when you talk about class that you can kind of reproduce a similar thing. And also what it does is it really reproduces the kind of this victimhood around class, this idea that people are kind of powerless and they have no agency in how to fight back against these things. I think this is one of the hardest messages to really deliver as well. This idea that class is both this kind of vicious divide, this vicious thing that divides us, but it's also potentially a social bond that can help us overcome that inequality. You know, that's a really hard message. And I think one thing we've seen with the demise of Corbynism and the electoral defeat of Sanders is the fact that it's really hard to win electoral majorities off a kind of that kind of message. You know, people don't necessarily, you know, it's hard. The concept of class has been so kind of degraded over the years that a lot of people have disidentified with it as a kind of positive term. You know, they don't see it as something that, it takes me back to the point I said at the beginning, they don't see it as something necessarily they want to identify with. The working classes don't want to be like seen as the working classes because of the fact that it's been kind of demoralized as a term. You know, Owen Jones talks very well about this stuff, or Beverly Skeggs talks very well about this stuff, the sociologist. The idea that with like Chavs and Benefit Street and, what's the other one? Jeremy Kyle, to be seen as working class in the public eyes, to be seen as kind of pathological and vulgar. And that's been such a dominant narrative of neoliberalism. And I think one of the admirable things of Corbynism and the admirable things of Sanders is that they didn't do this classic Labour thing of just like, let's not talk about class. They actually actively tried to challenge that narrative. Question, you know, and it's hard to do because we've heard this thing for 40 years. So there's a lot of work that needs to be done. But maybe, one of the ways in which we do that is by pointing towards examples of successful organizing around class. And there's so many across the world today and across history that we can't really do justice to it in the short time that we have now. I want to kind of give one example, I guess, from the very origins of capitalism that I think is quite nice. It's something maybe slightly happy to finish on. It's something we can think about when we go to bed tonight. So that's this. And I'm going to read the passage from the book. The average British person spends 8 hours a day from Monday to Friday at work. But who decided this? Unlike the 24-hour day, which is determined by the rotation of the Earth on its axis, there is nothing natural about the 5-day week and the 2-day weekend. In fact, until the 19th century, there was no concept of the weekend at all. Saturday was just another day, like Tuesday or Monday. In the smoky factories of the early Industrial Revolution, the average time spent at work was around double what it is now, a grinding 14 to 16 hour workday with only Sunday for rest, as instructed by the Bible. Now, we all know that feeling of a Monday morning, tucked up in bed and wanting nothing more than for the alarm to turn the alarm off and fall back to sleep. Well, 200 years ago, people felt exactly the same, apart from one small difference. Unlike today, where we reluctantly managed to drag ourselves out of bed, these early factory workers did the opposite. Having a more rebellious spirit, they simply slept in and took the day off to chill. This tradition of not showing up to work on Monday became so widespread across the country, it was given its own name, St. Monday, mockingly named after an imaginary religious figure. Needless to say, this didn't go down well with the factory owners. As St. Monday started to spread to Tuesday, panic also spread. Alongside social campaigners such as Sir Ian McKellen's, best known for his role of Gandalf in Lord of the Rings, great-great-grandfather, employees put forward the following deal to their employees. Factories will close early on a Sunday without any reduction in wages, so long as the tradition of St. Monday was put to rest. In 1950, the first law along these lines was passed, stopping work at exactly 2 p.m. on a Saturday, which is incidentally why British football matches still kick off at 3 p.m. Within a few years of the pact being made, St. Monday was no more and the weekend was born. So next time you thank God it's Friday, make sure to pay your respect to those disobedient descendants and their Monday lions. Cool. I think I'll probably finish there.
Great. Thank you, Ben. I'm just going to share a link to Ben's book from the Pluto website. Support your local-ish radical publisher. We've got 8 questions and some almost as many minutes. So shall we just go through them and see who we can speak to? Is that okay with you, Ben?
Yeah, that sounds good.
Okay, brilliant. So Ree Burgess, we're going to turn your microphone on. And
hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Great, fabulous. Really, really great talk. I really enjoyed the conversation and hearing about some bits and pieces that kind of I'd almost kind of gathered dust in my mind, to be honest with you. And I think one of the things we have to take from everything with COVID that's happening globally is the opportunity now for real positive change and significant and meaningful change. My question was around, is part of that answer maybe redefining what we mean by human capital? Because obviously traditionally human capital has kind of evolved as a term over time. Where we are at the moment is this kind of combination of habits, knowledge, ability, that kind of all combine together to essentially produce economic value. But things like the NHS obviously are loss makers and always will be. All care services are. Pretty much anything that we currently determine to be key, other than potentially some kind of, you know, retail establishments, etc., are kind of essentially loss making. So is there something to say around, you know, financial capital is important. We know that money does make the world go around, whether you agree with it or not. But do we need to redefine human capital? Is that where the answer lies to bringing about sustainable change? Because the people that we are now identifying as key workers are key to a functioning society.
So wait, so is your question that we should redefine human capital so that, for example, people like care workers have, we imagine them to have lots of human capital? Is that what you mean?
Absolutely, absolutely. And obviously, you know, there's something that goes alongside of that in terms of how we remunerate people for the work that they do. Mm. But in terms of kind of having that fundamental seismic psychological shift in what matters now post-COVID when we get there, and the world before, the world where, you know, the taxpayer can bail out the banker in 2008 and, you know, they can rise like phoenix from the ashes and yet the taxpayer will be bailing out this situation for a long time to come. But where do we want that money to go? Does that kind of make sense?
Yeah, it does. Yeah, I think that's a very important point. Like, so a lot, we saw a lot of this debate before between kind of skilled workers and unskilled workers. In January, obviously the Conservative Party tried to put forward this new immigration policy in which they defined, they used the term skilled and unskilled, yeah, like this kind of human capital concept. In fact, the term comes from a lot of the human capital literature in neo-Keynesian economics, which in which, you know, they try to explain some of the inequalities that we've been talking about through this concept of human capital, kind of design models around this kind of stuff. And yeah, obviously within that definition the Conservative Party put forward in January, I mean, care workers wouldn't have made a skilled worker, yeah?
No, exactly.
It was this kind of seen as this very like technical economic language of skills. There was actually just a reinforcing a value position about which people in the economy were considered valuable or not. And I think you're exactly right that like with COVID-19, I think the big change that you're seeing across the political spectrum is this change in what jobs are considered to be skilled and which jobs are not to be considered skilled. Like, I don't know, I feel like I'm often maybe a little bit too optimistic about these kind of things, but like, I don't know if any of you guys saw the kind of Piers Morgan thing that happened the other day, like the thing that he was saying about how he spoke to his cleaner, who was a Filipino migrant, who he didn't realize that basically all of their friends worked in the health industry, the health sector. And he kind of just had this kind of splurge on live on air, basically being like, oh, wait, maybe these are actually the workers who are the most skilled and the most valuable. I feel like when somebody like Piers Morgan is saying that, there is a bit of a shift in perspective in the country. And I do hope, I think organizing has to be built around this kind of stuff. One of the things that I think is interesting is the fact that obviously within things like care, you know, if we want to redefine stuff to say like where does this redefinition come from? You know, like how do these jobs suddenly become seen as valuable? Okay, COVID might go to some of the way. I think labor organizing has to be the other side of the coin though, yeah? Mm-hmm. And labor organizing in a system like care obviously comes with other challenges that maybe aren't there when you're organizing coal workers to go on strikes, for example. Let's say, you know, going on strike if you're a coal worker versus going on strike if you're a care worker are very different things. Mm. Coal doesn't care if you don't mine it. Like, care is like a form of effective labor. Yeah, people who do the care work are care a lot about the people that they're looking after, which makes kind of striking a very different thing. Or take teaching, for example. Like I alongside my PhD, I do like GTA teaching work in a university. We've just gone on strike. It's a very similar thing. I mean, this isn't to say that like strikes can't happen in this sector. Of course they can. Like, they do all the time in the care sector. Last year there was a strike up in the north, I can't remember where I think something like 600 care workers went on strike I think in 2014 some care workers went on strike as well after they moved from the NHS to a private equity firm and their wages were going to go down, and so they went on strike to protect their wages and won. You've also got people like in the IWGB, you have the foster care workers branch who are organizing foster care workers. I mean, if there's any example of success, you know, that you can do successful organizing in an issue of effective labor, it's got to be that. But I think this is a big question. Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you.
That's right.
Thank you. The next question goes to me. I can confidently say you're not me, but me. We'll just turn your microphone on for your question. Can you hear me? Me. me doesn't seem to be there. So I'm going to read out their question.
Again.
How, in your opinion, can we as consumers, citizens and taxpayers hold these multinationals to account a little bit more beyond the fluffy words they put in their corporate social responsibility statements? How do we actually judge companies on their ethical scores?
I don't think I quite heard the question. So it was basically, how do we hold multinational corporations to account even when they're doing this kind of crappy corporate social responsibility?
Essentially, yeah.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think corporate social responsibility and philanthropy is a very effective tactic used by the capitalist class to legitimize their wealth. I mean, I think we have to be very honest about that. In the book, I talk about Warren Buffett, who's the third richest man in the world. I use him a lot because he comes up with great slogans. Like, he's got a really good slogan for defining capital and labor. He says, the difference between people that make money while they sleep and those that work till they die. And I thought that was, you know, from the third richest man in the world, it's kind of a neat summary, if not kind of a sickening summary of how the world works. So he's very famous for basically probably being one of the biggest philanthropic donators in the history of the world. You know, he's given away £40 billion or something and done a lot of good with it. But what we need to look at is the fact that the accumulation of these billions has been premised and based on the exploitation. And, you know, it's basically the wealth has come from systems that really reinforce the poverty and the inequality that this philanthropic money is trying to kind of is trying to solve. And I go into an example of that in the book that I'll kind of leave for the moment. But I think one of the key things really in maybe one of the kind of key ways that we tackle this is around the issue of taxation. If you look at how much the top kind of 100 billionaires in the US, I think they talk about the US because the stats on this, versus, you know, if you look at how much they give in philanthropy as a proportion of their wages, as a proportion of their wealth, versus how much tax they kind of could pay if we slightly changed the tax system as a proportion of their wealth, they're paying a tiny amount. It's something like 0.01% of their wealth each year. If you want to look up the statistics on this, I'd really recommend reading a guy called Gabriel Zucman. He's a French economist who does a lot of the work on this stuff. And so really, I think the way in which you solve this, which is kind of what Sanders put forward, but maybe what we could see in Europe as well, is higher taxes on the wealthy and on corporations. I mean, it's not a historically unprecedented. In the 1970s in this country, we had marginal top tax rates of over 90%, and the same in the US as well. Now they're, I think, are like 40% or something. Or take something like corporation tax. It's kind of massively declined to its historically low level now. So we really need to just be saying like the only reason why the wealthy can give so much is because of the fact that effectively the economic system is, and the tax system is rigged to allow them to accumulate so much wealth in the first place.
Okay, thank you. Ryan Davey, we're going to put your mic on next, and hopefully we can hear from you.
Hello, I'm assuming you can hear me, so I'm just going to...
Yeah, I can hear you.
Great. So thanks so much for your talk. It was really excellent. And I had a question about forms of exploitation outside of employment. So yeah. If what you're looking into in your book is what's driving class inequality in today's world, especially in a post-industrial society, then what role do economic relations other than formal employment have in class exploitation? In other words, can you get class exploitation outside of employment? So examples I was thinking of was like money lending or landlords' relationships with their tenants, or where childcare or housework is done without payment. Would you consider those to be class relationships or exploitative activities?
That's also a very, very good question. Sorry, something's going wrong with my mic. Definitely. I mean, I've focused here on the idea of exploitation being based around the workplace, but of course, these other inequalities, particularly around assets like like housing, for example, they're very deeply connected to them, and you know, it also reproduces class in lots of interesting and kind of perverse ways. I mean, let's think about it as an example, like maybe a more kind of concrete example. Let's take the issue of housing. Yeah, I think the relationship between a landlord and his tenant is clearly like it's a different relationship to one between bosses and workers, but it's undeniably like a relationship that relates to one of the class divides that exists in Britain today. And I think particularly with something like housing, what we've seen is, one of the kind of questions is like, why is this relationship so strong today? You know, why is housing so expensive? And why are so many kind of people having to go into the private rental sector? And there's been like lots of narratives about why this is, you know, why a house price is going so up. And I think one of the kind of, one of the main ones that you hear in society is this idea that, you know, like Britain is full up. There's just like too many people in Britain, which points the fingers at migrants. Yeah. It's like too many people have come in. We're like at breaking point, which is what the famous Brexit poster from Farage kind of said. And when you actually look at what's kind of causing house prices to increase, it actually has absolutely nothing to do with population levels. So I said earlier that house prices increased from about 1999 to 2008 by over 200%. During that period, I think something like for every four new houses that were, sorry, for every three new people that were added to Britain's economy through population and migration, for four new people added to Britain's population, three new houses were built. In other words, like there were enough houses being built to match the increase in Britain's population. The reason why prices have gone up so much is because housing has become a lucrative financial asset for capitalists to effectively park and make money off. You know, bringing back the hedge funds and the private equity firms, at the same time as them going into care homes, what they've been doing is buying up huge swathes buying up a lot of like financial products that are based on the housing system, buying up property themselves. Housing's really become this kind of financial asset to make money rather than as like a house for people to live. So it's connected into the same economic system of exploitation. And also clearly the relationship between landlords and tenants is one of, you know, it's a class relationship. Yeah.
Thank you.
That's right.
Okay, next question is Gilles, or Gillet, my apologies, Morin.
Yep.
And you're there.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, my question is about wealth.
Yeah.
At what level does a source of income become surplus to requirement? Let me give you an example. If I'm a CEO earning £200,000 a year, and I'm already spending less than I earn, what would be the incentive of me getting an extra 400,000, another million? And what kind of mindset would prompt someone to ask for more?
It's a good question. Yeah, I think. So basically you're saying, is your question basically like, what kind of person would want to ask for more? Or is your kind of question like, how do we like actually economically define where this cutoff point is?
Okay, I mean, if I'm already earning £200,000 a year, and it's more than I can spend, I'm not doing any good to the economy. So would it be better to just give other incentives to a CEO other than money, and then dish out this money to people who really need it, and then who will, in return, actually spend more and fuel the economy?
Yeah, I mean, I see what you're saying. Yeah. So there's this kind of classic point, I get this is a point put forward mainly by post-Keynesian economists that say one of the reasons why the economy is kind of so stagnant is the fact that you have these huge inequalities of wealth and income, which mean that effectively all the money is stuck up at the top with people who just can't spend it. You know, if you're one of these top CEOs, even if you wanted to spend all this money, you just physically couldn't be able to, if all that money was redistributed across people at the bottom of the distribution, they would all spend it, which would drive demand, which would drive growth in the economy. So you're kind of saying like, why don't capitalists kind of seeing the fact that this would drive growth want to redistribute money down to those who are poor? I think there's different ways of answering that. I think one way, maybe a Marxist perspective, would be, well, you kind of don't want to give, in a way it's, I mean, okay, there's different ways. One might be that as a class, capitalists aren't particularly well organized to be able to do this kind of thing. Maybe back in the day they did, under the kind of golden, what Eric Hobsbawm would have called the golden age of capitalism. This was kind of the model. You redistribute money back to wages so that wages increase with productivity, so that workers can buy the products that capitalists want to sell. I mean, there's a nice phrase about Henry Ford going, taking Henry Ford and a unionist going around his factory when he had mechanized the production of the factory. You know, and he was pointing to the kind of trade unionist boss, and he said, you know, how are you going to get these machines, you know, joking with him, being like, how are you going to get these machines to pay your union subs? And supposedly the trade union boss kind of quips like, or how are you going to get those machines to buy your cars? So yeah, definitely this is like a part of, this has been something that's thought been kind of like part of a system of capitalism before. I think what we've lived in now since the 1980s is the way of getting around this problem has effectively been financialization. You know, rather it's okay to make sure that it doesn't matter if workers are remaining poor, so long as you can effectively inflate the economy with as much debt as possible to stimulate demand, which, you know, that's effectively what's been happening. So that, I don't know, let's think about it. Like that was quite theoretical. Maybe let's think about a practical example. Something, I think like student debt is a classic example of this. People in my generation, as I said, faced 12 years of stagnant wages. One of the ways in which you try and increase demand for a load of people who don't have any wages is give them a load of debt, and then basically they don't pay it back because most people, like over half of students, haven't actually paid back their debt. Okay, that's like a classic case of financed demand driven growth. But clearly the whole thing's absolutely unsustainable and it's going to blow up one day. But capitalists aren't necessarily that well organized or as a group to be able to solve that. You know, that's why we have business cycles and crashes.
Thanks, Ben. We're running slightly over. We've got time for a couple more questions. Before we go to the last two, just to remind everyone that Conway Hall is a charity. It is our charitable mission to deliver talks such as Ben's, really to promote a better world. So if you haven't already, do please donate to us. You go to the website, you can find the donate button. Otherwise, I'm about to put the link out to you all. So hang on a sec while I'm doing this. Okay, begging letter dispatched. Next, Cameron Aitchison-Labar. I'm going to try turning your microphone on, and let's hear your question, if we may.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Wonderful. Yeah, thanks for the talk. I've got your book, haven't got through it yet, but yeah, big ups.
Oh, to nice.
Big ups to yourself. Anyway, quick one. Do you know of any anti-racist movements that are working within the UK to tackle some of the things that you spoke about not letting class divide us, and you know, that we really need to rally together in order to, you know, overcome or move forward as a society or as a movement and stuff like that when we are facing, you know, constant resurgence of neoliberal rhetoric and far-right rhetoric that is popping up all over Europe and America and I guess the world. So yeah, mainly the UK context I would be interested in.
That's a great question. There's obviously a lot of trade unions who are doing really good work on this stuff. There's, I guess, the two that come to mind who seem to do a lot of work organizing with migrant workers are the United Voices of the World and the International Workers of Great Britain, so the UVW or IWGB. A lot of their narrative, not their narrative, actually what they do, and I think do very well, is win wage increases for some of the most low paid and precarious workers in our economy. UVW, for example, has been successfully organizing cleaners and security guards in the NHS. These are like practically, I think potentially even 100% migrant or BME workforces were kind of involved in one of the struggles. Like a huge number of their members are non-white or migrant. And they've been basically winning to push up wages, and their narrative for that is, you know, don't turn to the right to then, you know, the right are saying that migrants push down wages. Actually, it's completely the opposite here in this trade union. We're actively organizing to increase wages. In fact, and they've been winning some of the most successful things in the NHS, in universities, across different parts of the economy. So I definitely have a look at that. Yeah.
Thank you.
That's right.
Last question, I think. Sorry, we have I've had loads of questions. My apologies.
Sorry, guys.
We've got, it's fine, Ben. It's fine. It's been a great evening. Final question is going to go to Leonor Stangerlin. Leonor, I'm going to open up your mic.
Hi, Ben. Can you hear me?
I can, yeah.
Yeah. So you pointed out that the last financial crisis just increased wealth and in general economic inequalities in Britain. Yeah. And I would say part of it is due to austerity politics.
Yeah.
And since we are at the verge of an unprecedented economic crisis again, which I guess we'll see like huge expansionary state policies, how do you think could we prevent a second wave of austerity politics happening in Britain and all over Europe? And what's like, to come back to the topic of your book, what would you think would be a good class narrative around this issue?
I think that's a really good question. So I think one of the successes of Corbynism in the UK was to expose the fact that austerity is not an economic necessity, but a political choice. And, you know, this isn't even necessarily a left or right issue. You know, this is, I mean, the United Nations investigated, the United Nations investigated the UK three times over the human rights abuses of the austerity program. And in their final report, in fact, let me find the quote, because I write about in the book. This is the final report they write. So this is the United Nations, not, you know, like an independent international arbitrator. They said, quote, "Poverty is a political choice. Austerity could have easily spared the poor if the political will had existed to do so. Resources were available to the Treasury at the last budget that could have transformed the situation of millions of people living in poverty. But the political choice was made to fund tax cuts for the wealthy instead." So yeah, I mean, like, part of the narrative, I think, has to be, whatever happens with public finances is always a political choice, not an economic necessity. Now, as you say, we're entering into an unprecedented period for government debt. I mean, we're going to see government debt higher, I think, than it was even in the 1940s, potentially. We're going to see this, you know, a huge collapse in, I mean, I think part of the narrative has to be that in a way that doesn't necessarily really matter. I mean, it is not the goal of government to reduce government debt. I mean, this is just based on completely mad economics. There's a sense to which it might matter, but it's not by any means, you know, there's not like a cliff edge that if you get over a certain amount of government debt per GDP, then your economy collapses. I mean, that is the case in countries in the global south, who are much more kind of credit and financially constrained. But for a sovereign country like the UK, which is one of the richest countries in the world and is deeply embedded into financial markets, that's just not the case. In fact, at the moment, people are desperate for, to an extent, people are desperate for government bonds, and people want the government to be taking out more debt because it's a safe place for people to park their money in a time of crisis. So, you know, how will we pay for the crisis? I think what we're already seeing, basically, actually, I don't want to get too technical with it, but basically we're already seeing kind of like the same tools being used in the last crisis, but kind of at a much quicker and more deep level. So quantitative easing has already, you know, it took them basically a year to do quantitative easing at the last time. It's taken them like a few weeks to do, not, you know, a couple of weeks to do it at an even greater extent this time. So what that means is, I think, you know, one way you could kind of play with this is we could have effectively what the government's done is it's printed money. Now, whenever you kind of talk about that, people think, you know, Zimbabwe or Nazi Germany, the Weimar Republic, you know, printing money leads to hyperinflation, which leads to the destruction of the economy. And the British government has effectively done just printed money and, you know, monetized its debt in a sense. Not quite, but it's kind of like nearly there. This could be a way to do it. I don't think this would lead to inflation now. In fact, most economists say one of the problems right now is that we have too low inflation rather than too high inflation. We actually want inflation because it erodes down our debts. And this is one of the kind of problems, is that we're not getting enough inflation. So I think trying to kind of pay for it a little bit with inflationary spending will be one way. I think another way to do it would be with increased taxation on the rich. You know, but again, these are just kind of policy ideas without a government that would want to, you know, put them forward. Let's hope that the Labour Party kind of like gets behind a redistributive program when it comes to dealing with this crisis and sees like a bump in the polls from what it is at the moment. I think on an individual level, what we should do is obviously continue organizing in our workplaces and in our communities. While if you know you're working in this field, I think thinking about coming up with ways in which you can produce stuff to show that if the government tries to replay the narrative of 2010, that austerity is an economic necessity and we have to hit the poor, really just trying to just damage that narrative as much as possible, I think would be like as a researcher what we should be doing.
Okay, thank you, Ben. Thank you everyone for all your questions. As I said, we've got more questions than we have time. Thank you very much. We can continue the conversation at #EthicalMatters or in the chat. I've just put out Ben's Twitter handle. I hope that's okay, Ben.
Yeah, it's fine, yeah.
Again, his book, Split, Exploring Class Divides, is available from Pluto Press. We sent out the link earlier. We're keen for a donation from you if you haven't done already. Thank you very much. Brilliant. Have a great evening. I'm going to close down the Conway Hall shed now. Thank you all very much for coming.